So that link, right? Never mind.
You're.
Oh snap! Papa Stackz. Papa Stackz in full Papa mode.
What's up with it? Long time.
Daddy Stackz.
You already know that. I see you.
What's going on, man?
With the Black Panther.
Yeah, man. Gotta do it.
Feeling that.
Do it for the people.
I'm feeling that.
Yo, this man got the flag in the back. How long did it take for that, man?
Real black up in here, you know what I'm saying?
We are all here.
Trumpers can't not be extra, man.
I'm just living my life.
You gotta do it, man.
What's up with it, y'all? How y'all been, yo? Are we live?
We are live.
Oh, damn.
No, but hey, this is what it is. This is like, welcome. You're getting to witness a little distant, socially distant red cup reunion amongst our guests. That's what's always hype about these is folks like, oh, hey. So we are live. We have started. I am going to make this intro quick because I'm super hyped for this whole panel, this discussion. Homies. Dope folks, we're here today. So really quickly, everybody. My name is Aisha Upchurch. I go by the Dancing Diplomat. And if the turn up is right, I'm Ace, do it, go through it.
Okay.
We don't know what level of ratchetry, refined or otherwise, this evening will call for, but you never know. We drop it low and we drop knowledge up in this camp. So I am the founder and the director of HipHopEX. We are an intentional intergenerational lab and programming project based out of Harvard Graduate School of Education, where we're endeavoring to create events, curricula, mashups, where we can just hear each other and develop our knowledge and deeper appreciation of the culture of hip hop in schools, out of schools, the arts, the scholar sectors, everywhere, because hip hop is everywhere. So this is our third year of existence, and we typically kick things off in October. And so this is our launch week. This is the first day of our week-long of programming, and we are going to have a dope conversation. So I'm going to intro our facilitator and moderator as my camera is going in and out of Zoominator. I don't know what's happening, just bear with it, y'all. But this evening's conversation is going to be moderated by one of our graduate fellows for HipHopEX this year, who's also a member of the Beantown Lockers. I was locking it up.
Okay.
Over here, seated pacing, it's a thing. Who was also someone that I've gotten a chance to can say most honestly and personally has been a supporter of hip hop through just meeting this person at different community events, at our conferences, and now also as a student at the Ed School. So I am proud to bounce past this thing over to our guest, Remy Fernandez O'Brien. I will be looking at the chat. Folks, feel free to drop information in the chat. Let us know where you're joining us from. If you've got questions, drop them in there. Use the Q&A function. We are also streaming live on our Facebook page, and I'll drop that link in the chat. But invite your homies to join us all week long. But without that, put your virtual hands together to welcome our moderator for today, Remy Fernandez O'Brien.
Hey. Okay.
Hey, y'all. How's everybody doing today? Oh, man. All right. So excited. We have some incredible, incredible, dope practitioners, leaders, scholars, teachers here today to talk with us about the question of, can hip hop and crump coexist? I think that's going to be a real nice and juicy one we can sink our teeth into. So we're going to start it off with this man right here, big homie of the Zendikit Crump Academy, member of Black Flag Dance Crew. I might mess this up, but Rips, Mets, Mabs, Nuff, grand homie of the shop. We got RIP, aka Big Zen.
Yeah. All of it. All of it. What's up, niggas?
Did RIP turn his video off, though? Oh, no. Oh, here we go. Okay, good. Yeah, we got you. How you doing?
What's up? Doing all right, man. Doing good.
I cannot. I can't. I can't even.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, we can.
Do you see me?
We can see you.
We can hear you. We can see you.
Feel me? Do you feel me though? That's the question. Do you feel
we
me?
We can feel you, brother, man. We can feel you.
Okay. Awesome. All right. Up next. We going ultra black. I got a toast to that. We don't fold the crack. We go
with occasion we rose to that. Fuck on postal. We going my track.
Growing up without the means for much, let alone dance classes, McKersin overcame a troubled environment, persevering to become the dancer, educator, and choreographer that he is today. With folkloric Haitian dance as his base vocabulary, McKersin started building a bigger arsenal with hip-hop, various forms of African dance, jazz, and tap. He currently leads workshops and lectures throughout the country and world oriented towards social justice and the roots of African-American culture and movement. Let's give it up for McKersin, y'all. God bless
success. Woo, woo!
Yay. Do I say something? I'm just chilling.
Remy, we can't hear that music. Turn it up.
Wait, you all can't hear the music?
Nah, you hogging all the tunes.
Wait, seriously? I've been talking to silence this whole time?
No, no, we can even talk. We just can't hear the music.
Man. Yeah, man. I had this great intro and everything.
It'd be like that, man.
My bad, y'all.
Wait till you see my post about my students today. You're going to laugh. It's about something like that, too.
All right. It was supposed to sound like this. Give it up for McKersin.
We going ultra black, I got a toast to that. We don't fold the crack. We going occasion, we rose to that. Fuck on postal. We going ultra black, watching the global change, hopping the coldest range.
And now we got the rewind, going back to introducing RIP, aka Big Zen, with his song. Boost, You. Y'all didn't hear my intro song either, huh? All right. It's all good. Last, but certainly not least, this time y'all are gonna hear the song. It's produced by Stiggity himself. We got some original music in the space. Let's go.
Hey.
I could feel the waves in what you do. Don't even have to talk about it. Uh-huh. You can tell the vibes in the way you move. Don't even have to think about shit.
Hey.
The way the doors open when you walk through. Your confidence is so erratic. I want you to be my girlfriend. So pass me the pop filter. So I can spit out the microphone master. You ever heard the harmonies and melodies and all of the intricacies around and in between her legs?
I'm just gonna go ahead and let this play.
Production. I was a physical labor, no interruption. And you can go and tax it to the game and my account will figure out how to file the deduction. She like, are you serious? I'm like, see, you're just a little bit curious. I got enough hustle for the muscle, the curious to where we need to go. So tell me, where you wanna go?
All right, Ashton Lites, also known as Stiggity Stackz, is a Boston-based black dance movement specialist. International competitor, community event curator, and life builder, creative consultant. Through his business, Stiggity Stackz Worldwide, he is committed to providing the space and resources to inspire individual and community level transformation while establishing Boston as a hub for creation and innovation within the freestyle dance scene. Give it up for Stiggity. Yeah, I'm playing it again. Yo, where can we get that mixtape though? When's that coming out?
Listen, I'm still cooking. It's going to be a little while, but just know, it's coming.
So welcome everybody. We have these three dope panelists with us today. Thank you so much for being here. Folks who are watching, we appreciate you being here as well. You can drop your thoughts in the chat. We'll be reading those out the whole time. Our question today is, can hip hop and crump coexist? And I was wondering, could we just start off with each of y'all sharing what is your relationship to hip hop, or what is your relationship to crump, or both if you want to share that? And how are you personally thinking about the distinction between the two of them? McKersin, you want to start us off?
I was stretching, man.
I'm gonna volunteer you anyways.
Is this like a quick thing, or is this like a quick intro blurb thing, and then next person is just like an actual, you're asking the question right now?
How about medium between those two?
Okay, cool. So I'll start with hip hop, since that's what was introduced to me first. I've been doing hip hop since I came back to America. I was born here originally, but my parents had decided to send me to Haiti up until I was 8, the second I was born. So I lived down there until about 8 years old, trained down there, danced down there. My grandma doing some Afro spiritual stuff down there, came up. And obviously, since we're like immigrants, I mean, it's not obvious, some immigrants come here with money, but we just didn't have it. So, you know, lived in rough neighborhoods, and the only thing that I had to keep me off the streets from doing stupid stuff was literally hip-hop. And what's funny about hip-hop is that it was just a language. So while it kept me off the streets, it also kept me on the streets, you know, because part of the dark side of hip-hop is that it does have street elements in it, you know. So it can keep off the streets, practicing, you know, dancing, rapping, whatever it is, but then you do gotta go on the streets to prove yourself, you know. So but at least it gave me something to like push me forward in life. So been doing it since, since I was a kid in like middle school, you know, just, you know, losing some battles, but smoking kids in recess, you know? So I've been doing it since then. And then I was introduced to crump around high school. Dudes would have ciphers in my basement. Purpose used to come to my basement. when my family moved to Malden, we would cipher in my basement. And this was, I don't know, what year was this? This was like 07, 08. So that's when I was introduced to Krump. Fell in love with it. I loved how raw and organic it was. I loved how untouched it was, unlike hip hop. So that was like my biggest like thing that I loved about it. And I don't know. I'm just here now. Just existing.
Word. Thank you, McKersin.
Yeah, man.
Rip, you want to take it next?
Yeah. So, Pete, my perspective on this might sound a little confused because it's not the conventional. So I'm going to just leave that at that if you keep up. I'm going to start off by saying this. I am hip hop. And I am Krump. So how can they coexist? Obviously, Krump was born afterwards. I was raised in an era where there was a lot of, and I'm going right into it, y'all, so
put your seatbelt on. Let's go for it.
There was a lot of gang shit, excuse my language. There was a lot of violence. There was a lot of, you name it. Some of y'all was there, so you know what I'm talking about. And hip hop was an escape at that time. This is, you know, I'm a baby coming in. I'm just hearing sounds and noises and music. And then, you know, over time, I was raised on hip hop and by hip hop, you know? And then I found this dance, Krump. Now the dance side of hip hop, it never spoke to me. You know what I'm saying? Cause it didn't reflect the things that I was seeing. Not one bit. Well, maybe that's because to piggyback on what McKersin was saying, I came into hip hop after it had hands all over it. He said it was untouched. I came into the touch hip hop. I didn't get the raw essence. I came in right at the end of the era. You feel me? So I was still, I was raised by hip hop. And my family, really, we're a musical family just in general. You know, grandmama's a minister. My other grandmama's a minister. I think my granddaddy's a minister. Like, so you know we singing. You know how it be. And so we're just a musical family. So my family, as a child, always allowed me to listen to music. So I was literally listening to like Eminem and 50 Cent and the Backstreet Boys. You feel me? Like there's no, you know, it was just music. But hip hop is the one I took to because unfortunately, it spoke to my environment. Now getting into Krump. The reason why I think Krump is so dope and the reason why I took to it too, especially as a dance, because I didn't care about dancing at all. Like I started dancing when I was 17. I didn't care about, I just like music, you know, because that's the family I came from, and I liked hip hop because it spoke to my environment. Then Krump was the actual dance that kind of looked like gangster rap, which is my favorite genre of rap, you know, rap. Hip hop dance don't look like gangster rap. We could talk however we want to, it don't. So that's what made me attracted to it. Like this dance that is not hip hop, not called hip hop, looks like the physical version of gangster rap. I likes that. And I can build off of that art. You feel me? Now the thing that I loved about the Krump, I came into it I'm in the beginning phases of it. Like I told you, I missed the era of hip hop. When it, you know, before it got famous and, you know, before you could get signed for it, before it got whitewashed. I'm in this era before Krump gets whitewashed. And this is so exciting to me. This is so exciting because I can say that I'm going to keep it street no matter what. And this is the thing that hip hop has lost because it's been washed. The real. And that's all I'm going to be talking about today is the real. What inspired the birth of hip hop? Struggle, violence, street shit. What inspired the birth of Krump? Struggle, violence, street shit. You see the connection here? How can they coexist? We have to remember that we're trying to escape the struggle, violence, and the street stuff. And we're turning it into an art. And we can't allow, we cannot allow this one, because we have another engine. You feel me? We got another engine here. We can't allow this one, the Krump engine, to be washed. And that birthed a person like myself, because I understand what this is truly about. This is the ghetto story continued. What I think is dope, and that's what I'm, and another thing I'm going to be talking about today is we need to, I don't want hip hop to do what like blues and jazz did to hip hop. Pass the torch. You know what's up. If you really know what's up, pass the torch. These little groups and clubs that we've been tricked into creating to annex power against each other for money, in fame and clout, whatever, and empires, with hip hop. They're forming in Krump too, but like I said, they're not. It's not washed yet. Pass the torch if you really realize what Krump is.
Mm. Thank you, Rip. We're gonna get deeper into that for sure. Would you mind, for folks who might not know on this call, would you mind sharing just like a couple of sentences about what Krump is for the totally uninitiated?
Okay. And I'm going to give you the full version of it, not the quick sales version of it, all right?
Yeah,
the reason
please.
Why I'm doing this. Okay. Krump is one of the first dances that I saw that looked like me, related to my story in full, but was associated with something more toward lethargical or spiritual dancing. We all know that dance is healthy. It's a physical release, it's a mental release, it's a spiritual release, and we all know this. Krump actually, because of how it came about at a point, you know, Krump was kingdom radically uplifting mighty praise. So it had the spiritual connotation that we was praising something. So it was spiritual. Because the leader ended up, you know, finding out some things about the religion he was under or the people he was following, Krump ended up changing, and now it stopped having that spiritual connotation, but it still has the spirit. You can't deny it. You can still feel it and see it. So let's start there. But what got me into it was not only that, like I told you, my family was ministers and stuff, and we had a young street church. It was literally something called Street Kingdom that looked like me that was talking about Jesus. I'm like, I'm with that. That's dope. Like, why not? You know what I'm saying? So that's how it got me. But how it kept me, regardless of the religious and the spiritual connotation, is the exact, the direct impact that I saw that it had on the communities and the impact it had on the communities and what I ended up seeing it doing in my own community as a said big homie. So that's this whole, and I want to break this fam thing down, because that it's really dope, and it's the reason why I came into it. Obviously we know it's a dance, it's an art to keep the kids off the streets, but it puts people like yourself, it could be random dudes like myself, like some, I've been battling these guys who've been dancing in schools their whole life, and this dance called Krump for the sake of keeping kids off the street at the end of the day. You feel what I'm saying? So, and I saw the power that it could give. And I saw where the power truly came from. You can't fake it. You got to kind of have some struggle in you. You feel me? And Krump is built on that struggle. And we can see if you ain't got that struggle. So, so Krump is literally, it's a brotherhood and a sisterhood of people who might be in, it came from a bunch of people around violence and negativity, trying to get away from it. The origins of it, the people who created Krump was clowners first. And Tommy the Clown started, you know, I don't know if you know your history. I don't want to give a whole lesson on that, but it's literally, if just to nullify it down, why I was like, I'm going to stick with this, is because I was like, I see young black men and women in their communities may having an impact on little boys and girls and keeping them away from negativity. That's what Krump is. And it's nothing more than that. We have the sport aspect of it, which the battle comes in. That's just fun. You know what I'm saying? We have the what I would say, call the practitioner side of it, where we do, we literally will be like, yo, let's just get up, put some music on and dance for therapeutic reasons. You see what I'm saying? Yeah, but that's really what, that's truly what Krump is. There's a light shined on it, like it's only battling. It's not. It's way bigger than that. It's way bigger than that. And that is why I do what I do. That's why I'm still going harder than this. And that's, and even if I didn't have a bunch of little homies, I would still be doing it, because Krump is just dope and it's healthy and therapeutic. It's lit.
Thank you. Yes. Yes. Wow. All right. Stackz, same intro question to you. What do you think?
Man, RiP with the fire right off the bat. You know right? what I'm saying? Came out guns blazing. I got some clips for you.
What the hell?
It's crazy out here. Yeah. Nah, you know, I guess I'm going to reinforce a lot of what RiP was saying, but to start off, you know, I am hip hop, you know what I'm saying? Like that's my culture, you know, what I feel like hip hop became as a definition and a symbol is just a manifestation of our truth, Black art, you know. It's how we express ourselves, whether it's through the struggle or whether to celebrate. It's just a manifestation of the same funk that, you know, goes all the way back across the diaspora, you know what I'm saying? So like that same energy that's been allowing us to create our own freedom, create our own worlds, you know, with what we have on our plate. So I was born into it, you know, as McKersin was also saying, and RiP was also saying, like, I grew up listening to all types of music, you know, you know, from blues on, like, you know, like music was a big part of my household culture. A lot of my families are musicians and singers and artists and rappers, producers, the whole nine, DJs. And I lived on a block that was, you know, had a lot of parties, a lot of bashment parties, the entire thing. So like I was always around music, you know, like I can remember waking up and hearing, you know, my grandmother, she was the first one to wake up all that. Well, actually technically my great grandmother, but she was chilling upstairs and my grandmother would wake up first. She would, you know, she would pretty much introduce us all to the day. But before everyone got up, she would be listening to like her songs, like her R&B, you know, 50s and 60s blues, et cetera. And then, you know, that would wake us up along with the cooking, you know, maybe she was cooking some breakfast. And then my great grandmother was yelling down like, "Man, I think something's burning." And then I would wake up, you know, catch that first light. And then, you know, by the time it hit like 8 o'clock, the door would open because there was always people in and out of the house. It's the family house. And then all of a sudden we would hear the competing sounds of the block. So like, this is just what we did. Every cookout, every party, every time my family got together, we was always dancing. We was always listening to music. We was just always in this spirit. So like, you know, I really do feel like that's our thing. You know what I mean? It's in reflection to the culture. And if you want to get deeper, you know, as my man Heaprock once said, you know, it's kind of a re-manifestation of the civil rights era, which is like pretty much how we're able to use these vehicles as tools to kind of find some sense of liberation, you know, from what we have going on around us. So yeah, it's deep like that. My dance journey in terms of Krump, I started with Krump in terms of like me, like really wanting to like practice dance. Like it was always around. It was always there, but you know, like RiP said, the dances didn't really hit my spirit until I seen the documentary Rise back in 2005. And that joint just, like, it just hit my soul. You know what I mean? Like I seen it, I felt it, it resonated, I connected to it. And the energy that was just kind of like emanating from it, it just like, it was like an infection and I couldn't stop thinking about it, you know? So I was crumping from that very moment where I first watched it at my aunt's crib on the bootleg a little bit before it hit the East Coast. And I've been crumping ever since. eventually got in tune with the community of crump, which exposed me to what I see and I'm dealing with now, which is the dance community. Cause you know, I feel like it's separate in a way from, it can be separate in a lot of ways from just the actual culture. You know what I mean? Like it's like give or take, but the crump community introduced me to the greater dance community where all these events and sessions and classes and all that stuff started to, you know, be coming to my peripherals and stuff, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, you know, like Rip was saying, man, the buck is buck, man. This is a street dance, you know what I'm saying, with movements that link to movements and languages that came before. I think it's all one big link. It's just, you know, different manifestations based on different neighborhoods, different time periods, different inspirations. But, you know, you can trace all of these movements back like generation by generation by generation by generation. And crump is one of the more recent manifestations of this same essence that sometimes we might call hip hop or sometimes we might call funk. You know, sometimes we might call it all these other things, but you know, it's the same energy. And that's like Rip was saying, it's the same. It's not different, you know? Like when you look at crump, you look at, you know, dances that articulate some of our natural expressions based on like what we deal with, you know? And you look at hip hop and it's the same, you know? If you look at hip hop, in terms of culture, you have the music, you have the art, you have the festivities, you have the events. It's the same with crump. You have crump music, crump, you know what I mean? Crump art, crump festivity, crump events, crump sessions. It's modeled like literally the same way, you know? So crump is an extension of hip hop culture. In terms of the actual dance though, it's its own kind of like separate category. And crump is like, you know, if we wanted to put like a more literal kind of like a metaphor, it's like the heavy metal of this hip hop genre. Like it's the mosh pit. Shout out to metal, big metal. It's the heavy metal, you know, and it's still untouched. You know, there's still aspects of hip hop that are untouched. But when we talk about like there's a growing gap between what is mass produced for commercialism and what is actually resonating underneath the surface. So like, you know, yeah, it's all still here. It's all still, anything that's real is going to be rooted in that cultural experience. So, you know, I'm involved in all these different worlds, anything that reflects, you know, what my energy vibrates with, which is, you know, my people and our experience and our celebration and our struggle. You feel me?
We do.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm seeing a few people in the chat saying they're really appreciating the stories and like the personal aspect of what y'all are talking about. And I just want to uplift that just because we're doing this conversation for Harvard or whatever, it doesn't mean you have to check your body or your family or your story at the door. Shout out to Bravo.
Shout out to Bravo. Check your body at the door.
So now like I want to move into a little bit more of an open conversation. Y'all don't have to wait for questions from me. But I do want to pick up on the thread about Rip talked about passing the torch. Stackz, you talked about situating hip hop and crump in this longer timeline of Black American culture or Black culture in general. And I'm wondering where you see that, like the future of that heading for both hip hop and crump. But is passing the torch, like what's the best way to do that? So those two questions, what's the best way to pass the torch and where are we heading in the future?
Anybody wanna shoot?
I don't mind. I believe passing the torches is as simple as this, and I'm not gonna muddy it up. You got the old, you got the new, period. You got the old, you got the young, I should say. Krump is the young, hip hop is the old. Just like you guys know in real life, sometimes there's a gap in communication and understanding. All right. Older people, if you ever dealt with someone older than you, they have a way of doing things that they can't and they don't want to let go of. Right. And then the younger people have this attitude like, well, we're not going to listen to you. We as a people, we have to realize where we at right now. And the young and the old need to humble themselves straight up. That's the only way it'll work. If the young and the old humble themselves, the old got to really understand where the young is coming from. And the young got to shut up sometimes and sit down and listen straight up. And that's just a fact. That's the only way we can actually cope. If not, we're doomed to repeat the same cycle. And then this is going to get washed. And then some other great thing that will be created from our oppression will come. You see what I'm saying? It's really about us taking the time to humble ourselves on both sides. Understand, really take the time to understand the similarities. Really look at the main focus. What was the purpose of hip hop in the beginning? What is the purpose of Krump? Let's focus on that and get to that, and stop focusing so much on little things. That, you know what I'm saying? Like, in my opinion, to make it plain, that's the problem. I don't feel like, now to bring it to it, I don't feel like me being a frontline crumper, I don't feel like we're respected and accepted. And I can say this through experience, as we should be in certain aspects. When we attend certain events, there is no connection. And sometimes I'm gonna be straight up, and if I'm bugging, I hope any other crumpers can speak up about it. When we go to any other dance styles events, because we go to stuff, we attend things, we even enter things. We enter stuff. I feel like they sometimes people don't want to be bothered with Krump. Sometimes I went to some stuff, they ain't even nothing for Krump. Like, they would just be like, yo, we got, I'm not to pick at nobody, but you know, we got our B-boys, they do their events, they'll be like, yo, we got a B-boys thing, right? And then, afterwards, we'll have an open style for poppers and like lockers. And I'm like,
yep.
What was like, is there acknowledged? Because we're here. Do you not see us? Okay. So I'm going to tell you this. Just from my experience, since we're talking about stories, I deliberately was making myself seen and known and bringing Krump to these dance floors and as many as I could, as often as I could. For a while, I was like, why are they acting like we not here? Y'all don't got no, your DJs don't got no Krump music? Like nothing? You don't see it. You don't see this energy on your dance floors. You claim we lose because you don't understand what we're doing all the time, and you don't see this energy on your, you don't see us trying to, we're bringing this energy to your group. Now, I can say over time, in this city, of course, I can say that started changing. We started, I saw the music changing, I saw the formats changing, I saw a blending happening over time. But still, it's like Krump is definitely undermined. I know, like, this happens historically. This is going to happen. When the next new thing comes out, you kind of shun it. That's just how stuff go. But to my point, Krump, now, oh yeah, okay. So Krumpers, and now I'm just being blatant about it. Krumpers, sometimes we're not humble. We are very, very arrogant in a lot of the ways and things that we do stuff. And this is true. And that's because a lot of the times, for a long time, we've been trying to get into, you know, connect with the communities and whatnot, and we're not accepted. Everyone knows what I'm talking about too, and I'm glad we're having this discussion. There is a clear not equal between Krump and all the other dance styles and genres. It's clear, and we're not talking about it, but I am talking about it, especially because we all know that like And I'm gonna say this too. Yes, this is good. I'm glad. My apologies if I'm speaking too much. Crumpers are the best dancers right now. We're better than the old dancers. It's a fact. We're producing better dancers. I'm not saying this arrogantly. This is a fact. When the new dance comes out, that's what happens. Especially if it has solidified foundation. It's supposed to just be kind of better than the old thing. Now, what's happening in the old thing is feeling, you know, like any other old thing does. It doesn't want to feel obsolete. It doesn't want to change its ways. It doesn't want to. So because it feels a little bit nervous, you know what I'm saying? Just a little bit nervous. It treats the better thing like it's not even there sometimes. It treats the better, you know what I'm saying? And that is what I was seeing a lot of. But this is where the humility has to come in. Crumpers. I truly believe that Crump is the best dance style out right now. It's a scientific fact. I'm sorry. Y'all not moving how we moving. No other style is. It's a fact. But that doesn't mean we know everything. We just got here too. This is where we need to humble. We do need to still get our history. You know what I'm saying? To hip hop. It's okay. We better than you. You're older than us. But you're wiser than us. Chill out. Let's meet halfway and take over the world. I'm done talking.
All right. Rip throwing down the gauntlet.
Yeah, this dude be going chop the shot. I'll reinforce, but also counter some of those points in terms of the context of the original question. How can the question was, how can the baton be passed? How can the torch be passed?
Yeah.
That's what it was?
Yeah.
Word. Yeah. So to reinforce, yeah, I think it's definitely to create more multi generational spaces that involve a lot more listening. And that's one of the reasons why I created Stacking Styles, was to create that space where we just start pretty much being more intentional about roles as a community and as a culture. You know, I really feel like our elders they play a super, super important part, you know, in terms of like their story, what they've been through, and how they've managed to maneuver and maintain through all these years. And that's why I have a panel discussion specifically for, you know, the elders in the dance community. So more multi-generational spaces that are not just motivated by dance, you know, cause it's, you know, all of this, we're talking about, you know, dance is always the vehicle, but, you know, dance is the vehicle for all the things that that we really want to say and do, all the culture, like, you know what I mean? So like, you know, we need definitely to continue to create more spaces that are not so hyper dance focused, so more conversation could happen, you know, and not even just across the dance culture, but just the entire community, period. You know, I feel like that can help with a lot because you get to see where people's minds are at, and, you know, rather than assuming, you know, based on what the energy feels like, you know what I'm saying? So definitely more spaces geared towards that. And I think that also, you know, being a participant is super important. You know, I feel like, you know, when you think about, it always relates to the family structure in ways where it's like, yo, like, you know, we always want and appreciate when our parents and our family members, our grandparents and grand siblings are there to celebrate our accomplishments and the moments that we're moving forward and stuff. So like showing up to the graduation per se. So I feel like there has to be participation. There has to be the intention to go out and vice versa, to go out and just support. I think that that's how the torch can be passed, and that's where the better understanding is created. So I, you know, I was probably one of the first crumpers to really like go out and actually like put myself into the general dance scene, like other dance styles, you know what I mean? And I wasn't really met with, I was met with a lot of different feelings, you know what I mean? But like my intention was just to learn and understand, you know what I'm saying? To understand what I was working with. So I did a lot of sharing, a lot of teaching. I was, of course, I was whooping a lot of people's ass on the dance floor. And so that kind of sparked some interest. People were like, damn, we can't beat them. We might as well fucking learn from them. But it created a space where I could actually share and talk about the dance. You know, she said, I love the humility. Hey, I'm just keeping it a thorough. Nah, but it created a space where I could actually share about Krump, you know, and through engaging with different dancers from different dance languages, we got to like learn each other, you know, beyond the dances. And that made room for more understanding. Like my crew, New School Assassins, like it was a crew with different dancers, you know what I'm saying? So like we had some poppers, we had house and wagon, we had some, you know, me, the crumper, and like we all just took the time to really understand what first our individual testimony and story on the dance floor, and then second, the vehicle we used to reinforce that story. So it created the space for there to be, you know, around the time where like other crumpers started to engage more, for there to even be like a kind of like a blending or a transition. And then when I say that, I definitely have to say like there is a energy, but I feel like it's not just, because I feel like it goes so far beyond the people in terms of language, you know what I mean? Like I feel like in any space you're gonna have, like we're dealing with humans with traumas and egos and all that. So like, it don't matter where you go. You could be in your own house, in your own block, and you're gonna deal with some of the energies that you deal with at some of these events or some of these, you know, things that people are organizing. So it's like, you know, you kind of have to come into the space, you know, with your purest intention on your chest, you know what I'm saying? And like, you know, when you vibrate on that level and you connect to people who are vibrating on that level, it creates more pockets for opportunity of just like exchanging and learning, you know? So that's what, like a lot of the spaces that I create are about. It's like, yo, how can we actually find the connecting points? Cause everything is connected, you know what I'm saying? So how we're able to talk across generations and communicate and build across generations, across different styles, across, like, it's find the connecting point, you know? Like, we all love music, you know what I'm saying? We all have, you know, at the root of it, at least, we all have we come from similar expressions, like, you know, similar dynamics, you know, we come from similar, you know what I'm saying? For the most part, come from similar struggles, same neighborhood, et cetera. So it's like, you know, focusing on that is, I feel like, a way for us to actually like build forward, you know what I mean? And I feel like I've been able to witness that that tension between the Krump dance community and different dance communities that were already like kind of like in this space where they were holding events and stuff like that. You know, but I don't feel like that's it plays such a big part until something blows up. Like, let's say, for instance, the tie-dyes and junior battle, you know what I'm saying? And that's when, like, you know, you start seeing emotions come out and people start saying things that's, you know, not really reflective of the actual goal, the actual root, you know. And I can honestly say, like, if we, you know, when you talk about all the hands that have touched these dances and have started to dug their imprint into the soil, like sometimes you're not even like, you might not be vibing with some of these people because they don't speak your language, you know. And that's like community wise. There's a lot of the dance, general dance world is not just like, it's not just the hood anymore. Like it's literally like it's, everybody's in here. It's a party. Like, and you know, we open those doors, you know what I mean? So like, you're not even really dealing with like the same language all the time. So you gotta move through that as well, that type of energy as well. So yeah, I guess that's all the points I wanted to make, if I can remember. Yeah. Go ahead, McKersin. Do your thing.
Oh, he asked for the two of y'all to talk about it. So I was just listening. I was absorbing since I'm still a student. You know, you're always a student if you want to become great, that is. But yeah, now I feel like y'all did a good job touching on it. I'm trying to think of something. No, I think y'all covered it pretty well. I want to hear what Remy got. What else you got for us, Remy? What food you got for us, Remy?
Well, it is 5:50, and so if folks have questions that they want to... Aisha, are we raising the blue hand? How are we doing this?
Oh, hey, you can raise your blue hand. I put your one hand up, I put your blue hand up. It's your virtual little hand raise, and we can invite you to pose a question. I do, like, as folks are putting those into the chat or you're raising your blue hand, I wonder, like, though, McKersin, and your work, particularly, I think, you know, all y'all are repping the Boston area as well as beyond, not just, but maybe, McKersin, I'm curious from your standpoint as educator who's in schools and as an artist who's out here in the community, what's your vibe on, like, how is hip-hop dance and crump, how does it come up and how you see it being appreciated in this very particular community that we're here in? / what you wanna say? That's
funny. So I used to be like all into like the battle culture and stuff like that. It's funny because like Stiggity was entering. That's when I was like kind of like stepping away from the battling culture. So we kind of like did this. And the biggest reason why for me was that while it was dope for us to exist in the space we existed in, we felt safe, you know, like we seen the same people going over and some people would come from out of state to get smoked by us, you know, it was cool. But the issue I started seeing was that like we were so insular. You know, like I wasn't seeing new kids from my neighborhood come up in our scene, you know, and I was like really bothering me. I'm like, yo, like, and we teach people, but it'd be people who just come to the battles who are like, yo, you're dope. I want to learn from you. You know, so like I wasn't seeing kids from my neighborhood come up to smoke us. Like I actually want to be smoked by someone from my neighborhood. Like that'd be dope. You know, like that's the goal. Like hip hop was for the youth by the youth, you know, and like, for me to not see that exemplified in our own culture, that really bothered me. So I was like, you know what? I'm gonna focus on finding a way to get what we're doing right now back into where we live and then back that way. You know, kind of create like the Zendikit logo, the infinity sign, you know, like to make it flow back and forth. That was the goal. So once I seen that, I was like, how do I do it? So then like, I'm an RPG player. Like I love RPGs, like role-playing games. I love building stats up to get something to happen at the end. You know, that's how I work. I don't care if I start with a dollar, right? I'll turn that dollar into a mil in like 10 years. That's the kind of person I am, you know? So I was like, okay, I have to baby steps. So I was like, I get my name out there. So stat. So I started taking what I know, started bringing it into the theater world. So I started performing in the theater world. I remember one year I did straight up only ballet and modern, and I didn't like that. That really bothered me. People started to call me out on it, like, yo, bro, like, what are you doing? Like, we don't even feel like we know you anymore, blah, blah, blah. So then I was like, all right, bet. And I started to feel weird, you know? Like, I started to feel like I was pushing away hip-hop a little bit because I was getting paid way more doing modern ballet shows and traveling with them than I would be doing, like, hip-hop, you know? And for a little bit, I did lose my way, you know? And that's all I was doing, because it was paying good and my name was getting somewhere. And afterwards I was like, you know what? Literally just fuck this. You know, I'm gonna be me. I'm not like, I'm not being true to myself and my culture if I'm gonna just let y'all pay me money based on what y'all want to see from me, you know? So after that, I started bringing who I was, and it actually helped even more, you know? I felt like I progressed more telling my story and our stories than I did telling their stories, you know? Because they want to hear our stories, they just don't know how to ask, which is the problem I'm seeing. You know, people want to hear stuff that's happening out here. People want to see it, you know? But people just don't know how to ask for it. People don't know how to even come up to us to ask. Like, can you imagine a lady from Newton, Wellesley, coming to the hood where I live? I live in H block, like right outside is H block. These were the hottest neighborhood in Roxbury, Dorchester. Like you couldn't walk through here without like literally permission. You know, can you imagine coming here and going, hey, we want to know what gets y'all up in the morning. We want to hear why y'all love playing music at this hour. We want to hear this. We want to learn about y'all. That's not happening. You know, they're not going to come around here. And we have a lot of stories, and I was sick of seeing the same white stories on every freaking stage, you know? So I was like, you know what? Let's get together, group up, because we got stories too, and we'll make it happen. RiP is in one of my productions, and I got many more productions coming out, and he's going to be in, like, every single one, God willing, you know? Praise be the ancestors if they're about that life. But, like, I decided to go to education because I wanted my kids in my neighborhood to, you know, learn of their own culture, because I want them to... Like, because hip hop was made by the youth, like Ku Herc, when he threw that party, he was doing a back to school party. Like in 73, 1520 Segwick, that was a back to school party. You know, that was crowned as like the beginning of hip hop. You know, like hip hop had a lot of hands in it, but that was like crowned like the starting point. And that was the back to school party. That was for kids. You know what I mean? That was kids literally trying to fund their way back to school. The Bronx was hot, literally hot in that decade. There was like, it was like 13,000 fires in 76. You know, every year there was so much fires in the Bronx. You know, I'm like, these kids, they're just trying to make way for themselves. And then what did he use? Hip hop. They use music. They use gathering, you know? So I just want these kids to do, you know, because these blocks are hot, you know? They don't got much around these blocks, you know? Like, they're being ignored. Policies are being made against them. Even as an educator in the public schools, I'm seeing some crazy policy that is catered towards kids who have more means and not towards them, you know? And I'm seeing that, and I'm like, you know what? I don't see much of people from my culture in the schools right now in my neighborhood, so I'm gonna step up, you know? And when I come into my school and I want change, I step up hard. I bring my hip hop culture. I don't change the way I talk. I don't code switch to superintendents, whoever comes in the building. I go, hey, this is me. Welcome to my neighborhood. What's good, you know? So what can we do? How are we gonna help these kids out? I've thrown money into the schools. I've got money from this neighborhood and thrown into the, you know? So like, that's hip hop. You know, that's organizing. Hip hop's all about organizing, you know. These people, you know, they're one of my biggest idols, you know, to me in the world. You know, Black Panther Party, I learned a lot from them. You know, I study a lot of their books, a lot of their doctrines about how to get your community up. And that's what hip hop is, you know. And like, that part's not dead of hip hop, you know. A lot of people believe it's dead. Hip hop is dead. I'm going to argue with you, Nas. I love you, Nas, but it ain't dead. I mean, I know you're just saying a statement, but it ain't dead, you know what I mean? Like, it's still out there. Stack's still out here rapping on, battling folk. RiP's still battling folk. RiP's rapping. Yo, RiP sings and raps. RiP sings. If y'all want to hear RiP sing,
ask me. Oh, wait a minute. Are we going to have a straight-up talent show?
Yeah, okay. RiP will sing for you. I had RiP singing in the show. RiP sings. The jig is up like Nate Dogg.
What?
He's the R&B nigga of the block. What up, Nate? RIP to Nate Dogg, but you know, it still exists. The culture still exists. You know, the peace, love, and unity still exists. Has it gotten smaller? Yes, it did. You know, is it being washed and being like overseen by like the dominant culture who wants to nitpick what they want from our culture? Yeah, that's happening. But you know, that's the only way I feel like in this day and age that we can rise up using hip hop and crump culture. You know, so. My way to attack it is to get the kids up, you know, like get my neighborhood up. I do a lot of community organizing. I want people to rise up like these people did. It's hard, of course it is, but I'm a community person, you know. I'm a kids person. The saddest thing I heard last week was I was showing a video of Krump in my class last week, and one of the kids was like, "What is Krump?" And I was like, "Yo, that's wild, because in my generation, we couldn't ask that question because Krump was so hot and in your face growing up when I was in high school. It It was everywhere. Chris Brown was crumping. You know what I mean? Like everyone, it was the thing. It was the fad back then. You know, to people, it was the fad. Instead of being a culture, to the, and that's the thing about like dominant culture. They make everything a fad. You know, they absorb what money they can for it from it. They suck it dry. And the problem with crump to the dominant culture in Hollywood was that crump was so real that if you tried to absorb any more of it, the people wouldn't be able to fuck with it because they can't replicate it. Crump is very hard to replicate. It's very hard to water down because it's so spiritual and so raw and rugged that like you, it's hard, you know? You can't water that down. Like you can't, you know? So because of that, the fad didn't last that long for crump. You know, I went right back to being in the streets, and I was blessed to grow up in a generation where it was everywhere in our faces. You know, it was in movies. Chris Brown was doing it. It was in music videos. It was on the streets. So like as a kid, I wouldn't dare say what is crump, but to these kids, yeah, they'll ask that question because they're being born when crump was, they're born around the same time as crump actually, you know? So they don't know about that. They don't know what it is. So that's what I'm here for, you know, tell them all the great stuff we've done. We invented crump, we invented hip hop, we invented this, we invented that, and it keeps going. I want y'all to invent the next thing, and they will, you know, these kids will. Every generation, there's something new coming out, and they will. And I'm looking forward to seeing what they do with it. So that's how I see it.
Beautiful. Actually, folks were dropping some questions in the Q&A that y'all can't see, but
oh, I can click in it. Oh, there it is.
Sean McCarthy had asked, like, how can we be, what can we do to be more crump inclusive and make sure our kids know? So McKersin, you were just touching on that.
Crump the best style.
But yeah, so somebody does have this question, and I'm just gonna do some like real quick administrative type of little jump in here. We have blasted that this will go till 6:15, but we will probably hold because it's real juicy right now. We got to hear this duet that's gonna be happening, and maybe a little dance off. Nobody dance. Okay, they didn't say that. All right, so we're gonna extend to 6:30 for those who can stay on. But I just want to point. I think Rip, it was you who said crump is the best style. So somebody has this question: why is crump the best style? Was it meant to be better than hip hop or in general compared to all other dance styles?
Yo, Rip, you want me to answer?
Please, I'm gonna shut up.
He's just gonna give y'all the same answer. He's just gonna give the same, Rip ain't changing his answer. He's just gonna tell you because
I can elaborate. I can actually
elaborate. Yeah, he will. I'll give my take on it. Me and Rip be talking. We spoke about this a couple of days ago, on the phone. I love hip hop. Like hip hop resonates to me more than crump in terms of dance and everything, right? But as a black person, especially someone who's very connected to his ancestors, someone who is still doing research on how our dancers of the ancestors are in today's movement, because it is, you know, like, mm-hmm. I remember when, after I came to America, I seen hip hop and I was like, wait, we do that in Haiti, you know? And we weren't doing hip hop in Haiti. Nah, the moves that y'all were doing up here in America, I was like, that's the same move, just call something else. So then I was like, wait, maybe hip hop dance came from like Haitian movement. And after doing some research, I'm like, wait a second. That's because the jazz came from the Haitians who came up in New Orleans after it was bought. Like all that's connected, you know, the bambula, all of, like there's so much history. You could teach a class on this, you know, there's so much movement history. So I was like, wait a second, everything's connected. And then when I started doing African, I was like, wait, we also do that in hip hop. So that traces. So where I'm going with this in front of being the best dance is hip hop sadly has been touched by a lot of people who want to make it for themselves, and not for the best of reasons. You know, I love hip hop to death, but if you go out there, ask someone what is hip hop, they'll give you a bajillion things that is just not hip hop or what their idea of hip hop is. If you ask someone about crump, I prefer someone to say, I don't know what crump is, than for them to give me the same response they give me for hip hop. And because of that, I respect hip hop on such a higher level. Not that I don't respect hip hop, it's just I see hip hop up here in terms of blackness and how raw it is in terms of representing my color and who I am, then I do hip hop right now. I do love hip hop. It is my soul. It's who I am. But in terms of representing who I am, what I do for my people, like I'll raise up for my people. I'll burn something down for my people. Crump does that for me, you know? So If he says it's the best, I'm not going to argue with the man. You know what I mean? It does represent me more right now.
Beautiful. RiP, I know you want to jump in here.
Go ahead, RiP.
Something really quickly, RiP. Somebody had asked a question, which I think this will be a good segue for you to finish up one. And I see Ashton answered it. Since folks, our general public can't see it, I just want to speak it out loud. Somebody had asked for clarification. Is Krump not hip hop, or is Krump, or does Krump has its own culture? And Stackz had jumped in. Krump is not hip hop dance, but it is a part of hip hop culture. Krump dance has its own culture. So I know that, again, some folks who are joining us, these are probably the first time that they're hearing that we're saying hip hop, Krump, and not being like, oh, ain't they the same thing? So explaining McKersin, like, you ride for both, but there's a reason why you ride for Krump a bit harder. So just want to make sure that folks are hearing that they're related, but they should not be used as synonyms. RiP, we'll let you go in.
All right, hip hop enthusiasts, what are the four, or my apologies, there was one added. What are the five elements of hip hop? Need help.
Y'all better get in this chat with these answers.
Five elements of hip hop.
Do, 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 do. Ooh.
We'll start with the four I know.
I know people in this chat that know the four elements of hip hop.
Yo, Remy's calling people out. Remy's calling people out.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Oh!
There we go. So, where in that is Krump? Simple as that. How does it connect? Krump has its own elements. Krump has its own energy. So, now here's the thing. This is, I think my camera, can y'all see me? I feel like my camera freezing up and shit.
We can see you.
Okay, cool. Here's the thing. Krump was never in the conversation when those elements were created. Krump has its own elements. It's as simple as that. There's a connection that we have because Krump is the ghetto story continued. Like, hip hop came from jazz and blues. Jazz and blues came from whatever. Like, there's a line of our stuff. It's the ghetto story continue. So there's a connection there, but it is not hip hop. It is not hip hop. This is also speaking to why Krump is the best dance. There was a battle scene with hip hop. They're always, that was the thing. We would emulate, instead of taking out your physical frustration, you would do it with dance and art. You know what I'm saying? Krump did that, but took it to another level. Took it to a whole nother level. This dance was engineered to be better than every other dance before. You have to realize that. It was engineered to be the best. I have no professional dance training. How am I sitting here having a conversation with some of these people who went to colleges? Krump. It's a different dance. It got something these other dances do not. What is that something? I didn't even plan on dancing. I'm telling you, I've been battling people who've been in dance schools their whole life. Their whole life. You feel me? One had the dream of being a dance teacher someday. I ain't had no dreams till Krump came along. Then I was like, I just want to be buff. And I accidentally got good at dancing. Thanks to this. How did it get my attention? It did something, like I said. It took these movements and made it like a sport. Like, I could see the sport aspect of dance now, thanks to Krump. And I went hard with it. And just because I wanted to win, like straight up, just because I got... I got tight. You feel me?
So, we lost you for a couple sentences there.
Going back to it, Krump is not hip hop. Krump is not hip hop. Krump is not hip hop. It's its own thing. It's been set aside. It's established. You see what it is. If I came in and said something was hip hop, you guys will freak out at me as to why something is not hip hop, because it's been established, fully established. Krump is not in your books. It's not. That's all.
Just drop a mic and walk away. Pivot. Come on, Stacks. I see you got something.
You already know I'm cooking. Yeah. You know, I think that the only way to really break that, because I agree with what McKersin said in terms of like, when you ask somebody what hip hop, that's actually the first thing I do to my students in education is like, yo, what is hip hop? You know what I'm saying? Answer that. And you know what I'm saying? A lot of the times they don't know because they group everything into one. And I feel like, you know, there is a lot of confusion because when you're talking about hip hop, you could be either talking about the dance or about the culture. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like sometimes that is two like separate things. You know, one is inside of the culture, you know what I'm saying? But then the culture is like, when you talk about culture, like what is culture? What makes culture, you know? And that's like people, stories, identity, you know, language, celebration. And I feel like if hip hop became the name for that, you know what I'm saying, in terms of like Black people or Black arts, you know, then it's a continuation of that. So it's a part of the culture of hip hop, you know what I'm saying? But in terms of the dance, it's an entirely different dance. And it is, it y'all, it's deep. The roots are incredible. But I like to look at hold on, I'm reading what people are saying. Some do think it is hip hop, Percy, and some others believe it is a part of hip hop. Like is hip hop dance, because people call it hip hop dance when it is a culture that contains these elements we listed. Yeah, yeah, I'm pretty much reinforcing by saying that it's not disconnected, but when something has its own culture, like let's bring another dance into the discussion, you know, Chicago footwork, Memphis juking, you know, like they have their own culture and identity, you know, but they connect under what is already here, what is already present, which is hip hop culture, you know what I'm saying? But I feel like it's important that people understand the difference and acknowledge, because there are stories that get washed away the more general you get and you just start like throwing these labels on things that, you know, it just really doesn't make sense. And I think Stephanie also wrote at the top, and I wanted to answer, she says, not meaning to change the subject, but RIP earlier, but playing crump music at events. And it reminded me of what I was going to dispute and say about, you know, when it came to these events, you know what I'm saying? Like a lot of the DJs, of course, like when you're dealing with a culture that's new, there has to be like a conversation first. So like if you go to a dance event, if you go to like a hip hop based event or an open styles event, you got to remember the pieces that make up that event. There's usually an MC, there's usually a DJ, there's usually some judges, you know what I'm saying? It takes the conversation first for people to start opening up and understanding, like, you know, I wouldn't just assume that a DJ is just going to have crump music off the bat. You know what I'm saying? That's where the crump, you know, that's where the conversation has to come in first. It's like, I'm here with this buck. Let me show you what I got going on. Come back to my hood, see what we got going on. This is what's popping. You know what I'm saying? And I feel like that's no longer an issue in terms of the majority of like well-developed events. You know what I'm saying? Like good produced events have that rooted in that connection across all cultures, across all dance languages. You know what I'm saying? And I can say the same, and to also get into the question about best dance, I can say the same about the same thing. Like it depends on the dancer to me. You know what I'm saying? It depends on the dancer, you know, like as a culture in terms of like what's rooted. Yeah, crump feels more rooted now in the majority of crump spaces, but there are spaces with hip hop dance that are just as raw. It's just not out there as much. It's been, there is a lot of, in terms of like what is mass produced for the people, it's touched, you know what I'm saying? Like, but you can still find those spaces that are just as raw, just like in other areas. Like I've been to some light feast sessions that they was doing alien stuff. I've been in some flex events doing alien stuff, you know what I'm saying? Listen, I'm crump in my soul, but I feel like in terms of like, I don't feel like we do ourselves a disservice when we start to pit these things again. I feel like that's the conquer and divide mentality that, you know, where they always win because we have this like, this little chip that we want to get out. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, nah, like, I feel like we're better if we recognize, one, the connection, and we're better if we recognize the genius in all of these different dance forms and stories. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's literally, man, like, I don't separate myself or like, I'm open to all types of geniuses, man. Like, all types of, all different stories, culture, music. Like, and I feel like the more I get exposed to, the better I become at my root in terms of, you know, how I express, you know, and my choices and my decisions, et cetera. So like, I just wanted to say that and I'll leave it at that.
Well, I think we lost RiP. Been trying to get him back in. And I know there was another comment. I'm not sure if it was after or as you were sharing the person or RiP, but I do want to lift up that Aaron Myers, who was on, has shouted out that Monsell Durden has a talk about he talks about this morphology of Africanist aesthetics. And so Aaron's comment was, Monsell Durden has a great take on how white culture transcends space and time, and in spite of disruptions, which speaks to the resilience of Black culture. Eddie's back. I think what I'm picking up on hearing all of you all are like to this conversation. Conversation can get real contentious, like if we try to be like, what you doing ain't this, what you doing is this, what you doing is this. And I'm wondering as a final question to you all, like, knowing that there is this need for us to be able to tell the real about what are these stories, and McKersin, you're doing that in schools, in the community, Stackz, you're doing it in your own org, in the community, RiP, you're doing it through your organization, like, and y'all are still active. Like, even though there's all of this, like, there can be these debates, I'm curious for each of you all, like, what is it that brings, where's the joy? How do you make sure you keep returning to the joy? You know, y'all, almost each one of y'all started off your first response with, I am hip hop, I am crump. So what is it that you all do, or how do you tap into returning to, I am this, even with people getting it wrong, I'm in this, I love this, I'm gonna keep caping for it. So what makes you all return to the joy, even though there are people, your language and right on RiP, who are trying to whitewash, who try to co-opt, who try to commercialize and rip it from its roots? How do you all make sure you stay rooted in the joy and the fundamental essence of this, of these styles?
I guess I'll go. just continue to serve, continue to be a part, continue to grow and cultivate. There's no way that I can't, like, you know, when we, like I'll just keep reiterating, like, culture. It's like, man, like, when I go to my parents' crib or when my family gets together, like, I'm in this space. I'm in this space of joy. When I go to the crump session, you know what I'm saying? When I go to an event or a battle, like, you know, that's it. That's who I am. So it's like, I'm at home, you know what I'm saying? So continue to to nourish that, to grow that. And I feel like by pouring my energy into it, all the lessons that I've learned and my ideas, you know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like I'm nurturing that space to continue to foster joy, you know what I'm saying? And a big part of my mission aligns with what McKersin said is to actually, you know, because there is that separation between the dance communities and actual culture of it. I feel like what would bring me a lot more joy is to continue to work on closing that gap in terms of like the tools and the access, bringing it back to the neighborhoods where the kids who originally created this, you know, and continuing to put your hands in that and grow that, you know what I'm saying? And that's a huge part of my mission. So yeah, yo, that's that.
McKersin looks ready with some books over here.
I got like, there's no such thing as too much books. I have too much books for the time I have, I'll say that. Someone asked me what books I recommend topic of community. One of my favorite books, because I love to uplift the amazing power of Black women have had in terms of like where we are today as Black folk. I truly believe to my soul that without the works of Black women, we would not be here today, you know? And Black women have been like doing the uplifting and healing work of getting us where we are today while the world just beats down on us, especially on Black men, because we're seen as like the aggressor to society. And the Black women, you know, they don't let that happen, you know? Like they'll encourage us, right, put us up. 70% of the Panthers were Black women, you know? So I got this book right here. A Taste of Power, Black Woman's Story. So like it's a good book to pick up. I got this one right here. It's one of my favorite books. This is a new book. One of my friends took part in writing this book. She's dope. Her name is Day, Day Hernandez, and she's local. This book is called When We Fight, We Win. It's all about like community organizing, community action. Like there's a lot of good books that have to do with community that like I follow, I read. I just have too much over there to like just start picking out and like reading them, but like those two are good to start while writing the chat. What keeps me going, you know, I ask myself that question like almost every other day, because I find that I'm an angry person by nature, you know, maybe the Haitian hot-bloodedness in me. My family literally comes from like the Congolese people who actually helped incite the revolution. Like I'm just a hot-blooded person, and I'm not gonna, and I used to fight that, you know, I used to be like, oh man, that's not good, you can't be angry, but I don't believe that there's bad or good emotions. I just think they're tools, you use them as you want to, you know. I'm not out there beating people up, you know. I use my anger for change, you know. So like that, my anger, like when I look outside, I'm like, what the fuck, you know, that inspires me to work harder so that I can stop looking outside and being what the fuck. You know, that's my thing. Like anger motivates me to get up every day to do something about it. You know, that's my motivation. I'm gonna do something about it. I'm not just gonna sit by and just be like, oh man, this sucks. I'm gonna be mad and do nothing about it. No, I'm gonna do something about it. And that kind of keeps me going, you know. And hip hop, it has that for me. It has the beats that keep me grounded, you know. And there's psychiatrists who talk about this, like the bass in hip hop resonates to like the heartbeat of our mothers when we're inside their wombs, and that's like one of the things that like really resonates with us in like music. Like the fact that the bass makes me feel good and like wholesome, you know. The boom bap, the 2 and 4, that keeps me going, you know. And like I can't do nothing without music. I can't work in a regular job where I can't listen to music for longer than like an hour, you know. So like I wouldn't be able to work as a school teacher. And I've done it. I've taught math. I've taught science. I have a science degree. Surprise. I don't have a dance degree. I have a science degree. I'm good at science, biology, but I couldn't stay in labs. I couldn't work in freaking, you know, like all these jobs because I need music. I just need it. It just keeps me grounded, you know? That's just who I am, you know? Like, that's what keeps me going. And seeing the kids make stuff, yeah, when you work at a school or you visit a school, you see the stuff that these kids come up with. You're just like, yo, you guys are geniuses, like literally geniuses. So they keep me going. That's it. That's all I'm gonna say. That's what keeps me going.
So what keeps me going. Like I said, the main reason I do this is because, first and foremost, you got to do what you love. I actually just love Krump. Like I told you, like if I wasn't like respected or renowned for it, I'd be somewhere in the park doing it by myself because I actually love to dance. And I'm glad she's here. So Denari Harris, I don't know if you guys seen it in the chat. You know Denari, Mr. McKersin. she said that Krump is, she likes Krump. I'm gonna just tell you about Denari because she made me realize how beneficial it could be for a kid, and I'm glad she's here. When I first met her, it was through the 3-Point Foundation, and we were. yeah. Oh yeah.
All right, so, yeah. I was like, what? All
right. Yeah. So that was at the King School right here in Boston, and I taught a bunch of kids during that time or whatever. And, you know, some of them kind of just picked up on it and was like, oh, this was cool. But then some of them was like, they got the same hunger that I had. And you could see it in them. Denari was one of them kids. She kept coming up to me like, you know, after class, like, yo, but for real, though, like, you know, that little 30 minutes was cool. But could we, like, what's up with a real session? I'm like, you know, at first I was like, you know, haha, that's dope that you liking it. But, like, it's been a year now. You know what I'm saying? And she still hit me up like big homie when we labbing.
Bro, I thought it was someone else. She's more like a grown adult. Like I
that is Denari Harris. She's a smart young woman. Yeah, and Denari's I am very proud of her. I am very proud of her. She's very smart. And she's she has the potential to be one of the best crumpers in the world. I know it.
She's real like talk. 13, yo. I thought she was like a grown person. I didn't know it was the same Denari. I was like, this person
that little girl is my little homie, and she is one of the things that keeps me going. She's one of the reasons, of course, you know, all my whole family, the Zendikit, you know, the Rips, Mets, Nuffs, Mabs, my little brother, Dwight, you know what I'm saying? Like, my crew, Black Flag, they really keep me going because it's not just, we're not just a bunch of pompous jerks trying to prove we're better than everybody. We're really just a family, and we're actually just better than everybody at this dance thing. That's not our fault. No, I'm just joking. I'm sorry. That's not battle energy. My apologies. But that is... my little homies, my fam, my students, and like that's what really keeps me going. That's why no matter what's going on, no matter what beef, no matter what trash talk, like I could lose a battle. And like Denari will still hit me up, like, yeah, so when we labbing, I'm like, yo, you really still think I'm cool? None of that other stuff matters, man. Denari said I'm cool, man. and being like all jokes aside, and I know you guys can attest to this, you being a school teacher and you doing all that you've done, Stacks. Seeing the thing that we love and we do naturally, just some dance stuff, some art, music stuff, some art stuff, affect the youth and them just flourish with it. There's nothing more exciting than that. Like seeing them just grow with this. You might just be like, yeah, this is a step right here. And they're like, okay, cool. They walk away, come back like, yo, I learned how to backflip. Like I just taught you a step. That's exciting. I just taught you a step and now you go ahead. That is, and that'll keep me want to keep teaching. That keep me want to keep and then of course battling. I love battling. It's fun to me. I'm competitive. It's like chess. Battling is like dance chess. That's why I'm in it. And you can ask anybody, you can ask my dad. When we played chess, I played it like it was action packed. Like, oh man, my pawns. Like I'm competitive. You know what I'm saying? So, but yeah, that's pretty much it.
Beautiful. Like, shout out to Denari, who's been keeping us lit with questions. Shout out to the youth them. This battling is like dance chess. Well, then it's chess like dance battling, because I don't play chess well, but you know, I got a two-step. So we have a few moments left. And Remy knows this. That we have a little tradition that we do to wrap things up. Puns intended, wrap things up. So with...
Oh, yes.
So, you know, Zoom wasn't made for all of this, the culture, but we're gonna flip it as best as we can anyway. And we're gonna ask our guests whether your bars are oral, whether your bars are beats, whether your bars are some moves. We're gonna give each of you all, Remy, you can get in on this too, because you know how this game is played. We're gonna give each one of our panelists an opportunity to wrap it up how the spirit is moving. And I want to say something real quick. I'm going to give y'all 10 seconds to prepare with this little moment. What I definitely want to appreciate in each and every one of you all is that you are dope educators, you are dope artists, you are dope humans, period. This doesn't have anything to do with formal school or training, because I think also, I will say this as someone who identifies as a Black person, as an African, that it is in our lineage and our culture to learn through observation, to learn in ciphers, and that is formative, that is legit learning. It doesn't matter about the letters behind. So everything that you learn and we do, whether it's in the streets or in a classroom, where we got it from in our communal space, wireless transmission, yes, Aaron, it's real. And so it makes sense to me, Rip, that folks who have degrees don't understand what it takes to be in a battle, what it takes to just show up, be ready, stay ready, never having to get ready. So I just want to shout out that the ways that we learn, the ways that we transmit information through oral, through kinesthetic, that's legit. That's legit. So I just have to say that as somebody, I know we up in here on technically a Harvard Zoom link, and I am teaching at the institution, but I'm always going to shout out that Hip Hop Krump does not need the Academy's validation, because we're going to be whenever, wherever, however they want to be. And so if anything, Hip Hop and Krump are pushing on the Academy to be like, I dare you to leave us out. I dare you. So y'all dope. Y'all, that was all y'all got. That was all the prep time. I was high in the prep time. Ready, you ready? So it's
100.
It's hard to spit over a beat and hear both. So if you want to go a cappella, or if you have a track, DJ Rim Cycle may be able to hit that up. If y'all are still rocking with us, you don't want to log off right now. So the floor is open.
Who wants it?
Yo. I never had a writer's block. I don't know what that is. I'm on some other stuff. How would you classify my status? Call it bipolar, cause I'm subtle, but I'm savage. Then I'm mellow, then I'm rabid. Give me that, but you can have it going up, up, like I'm living a high life. Exposed to the sun, body glistening like twilight. Daytime, my life consists of fixing my stripes. Nighttime, I be freaking focused on what I write. I be going in. Lyrically, literally, the beat insists that I get open, so I'm listening, viciously, ferociously, attacking at your openings. I'ma be known vocally, if not wide, then locally, hopefully. Long as you know this isn't a joke to me, trying to make me stop is like chewing rocks with broken teeth. When I'm focused, I'll be trying to be close to me. Do me a favor, tie your neck around some rope for me. Let's go, McKersin. I see you just starting to get your head off, bro.
Gee.
Let's go.
What?
This is fuck. Oh my God.
Dang.
Let's go. What? Let's go. Yeah. Stiggity.
Check. Is my microphone wrecked? Check. Listen, check. Is the microphone? Listen, procrastination, the fear, the hesitation, replacing destinations for the need to feel complacent, but the calm's internal, and the storm is still existing, but it's passing blind eye, satisfaction or distraction. I'm active, barred by this non-productive action, but why never displays illusions of a different fashion? I'm on the runway, passing the pathways of my passion, gunning for the finish, but I'll never get it done. One, failure produces multiple lessons. One lesson, fall short of a blessing. You reckon our source is just too smooth? A lose is a win, but a win's not a lose. So choose what it is that you wanna do.
Leave the stack behind and get back into the group. Achoo. Can I please get to bless you? I recognize the truth and know that you're blessed too. Blessed too. Yeah, I know that you're blessed too. Put your hand over your nose and let me get in the achoo. Y'all blessed, dude.
I'm so
poly vibe. Blessed too.
Hey. Poly vibe.
We going. Hey. All right. I want to give so much appreciation, y'all. Thank you so much for being here, for sharing your wisdom, for making this the most live Zoom call. Oh, man. All right. We got, I want to let folks know, definitely panelists, if you want to promo anything that's coming up, do that in the chat or unmute yourself. For us, Hip Hop X Lab, this week we got panels every day, 5 to 6:15 p.m. Eastern time. Tomorrow, we're going to be talking with Dr. Tasha Iglesias, Dr. Freeze, and Matthew Morris. We're going to be talking about schooling with hip hop before and beyond class Zooms. Y'all want to promo anything?
Hey, stacking styles, you know what I'm saying? We going into our top four. I've been live streaming, you know what I'm saying? And this year we have like a huge community initiative. Like I had all these dancers, all these like big platform dancers. I made them go back into their own hoods and their communities and link with and partner with a grassroots nonprofit organization. And we're raising funds for a giant pool and they're battling for funds to go directly to their nonprofit as they move through the bracket. So we're live streaming every other Saturday. We just had a live stream this past Saturday. So in two Saturdays, it will be the top four. We also have 12 workshops left. We had 20 in total or 19 in total. Actually 20, yeah. There are 12 left. So if there's any dancers out there that want to take workshops, just go to stackingstyles.com. All the information is there. If you wanna hit us up on Instagram, we have a lot posting there as well. It's at Stacking Styles Official. That's the movement right now. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to everybody that was on here. Shout out to my brother McKersin, my brother Eddie Big Rip. You know what I'm saying? Put in that work. Thank you, Aisha, for having us on here. You know what I mean? For bringing the raw to the panel. I appreciate that. Appreciate all you're doing. And I appreciate you, Remy, for you know, being the host with the most, you know what I'm saying? Doing your thing and you know, spinning the tracks. You feel me? That was a nice instrumental you pulled up. You know what I'm saying? What you know about that? Okay. Nah, shout out to all y'all. I appreciate y'all for.
All right. Last final word, one sentence to Denari. Wrap us up. Wait. Yeah, there we go.
Hey.
What's up, Denari?
What's up, Denari?
Word. What up, Nari?
What up?
Anything you want to say before we head out? Final word?
Shut it down.
Thank you for all the things that y'all have said. I have learned a lot, and I definitely will take it. And it definitely made me a better dancer. And I also know what I need to do to make myself a better dancer to hip hop and also crump.
Fire.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Denari. Yo, thank you, everybody.
What you put out. I'm looking forward. Your life for you.
Y'all was bragging about how y'all just shut it down. So I would hate to embarrass y'all on this. Is we just gonna put a semicolon in it until we can meet up.
Not a semicolon. Good Lord.
Bro, queen is broken. Queen is spoken. Let it go.
No, y'all are amazing. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to our dope panelists. Remy, thank you for everybody who joins. Inari, you are officially part of the click.
Shout out to Denari, yo. Crazy with it.
Thank you.
Young people, feeling hopeful. Well, y'all know we know how to loiter on Zoom too, just like we do in real life. Howsoever.
Word.
Y'all ain't got to go home because you already there.
Hey yo. I'm leaving my house. I'm not going.
But you might have to sign up off of here. But at any rate, just for folks to know, we did live stream this. We will have recordings up on our YouTube channel, and they'll be on our Facebook channel after they're finished doing whatever the Facebook people do. But again, thanks to our amazing guests. Thanks to all of our attendees. Check us out all week long. Every month, the third week of every month, we will do week-long programming all school year long. Just a little preview, a little teaser. November, it being Hip Hop History Month, we're flipping it and making it Hip Hop Herstory Month. So we are going to be intentionally lifting up, celebrating, and elevating all women and femme-identifying folks and their contributions and voices to the culture. So just stay on the lookout for that. But tomorrow, we're going to get on our education tip. Wednesday, we got a conversation like, what school of hip hop would you call this? Are we post-hip hop? What's happening? Thursday, we want people to like weigh in and join our IG live party. Like, what's a throwback to you? Cause like I'm older, I got a little bit more spice in my seasoning. So old school to me definitely means a certain era. But we know hip hop is a train; people keep getting on additional cars. So what's a throwback to my college students, to my high school students, is different than me. So we want to know what from you all was hip hop. And then Friday, our final conversation will be translating hip hop to the stage. When does it work? When doesn't it? And why? So we invite you all to join us. Same time, same Zoom channel. Please show love to these artists. I will just say one last PSA. If you or you somebody you know has been chanting Black Lives Matter as of late, and they're not quite sure what that means beyond a hashtag on their social media, what you can do is go to these people and their fine organizations and show up with your coin, show up with your human resources, show up with services, with support that you can offer real live Black lives while they are alive, not just posthumously after our bodies have been taken. So,
thank you. Fire. Yep. Yeah.
Never miss
100%. I had to come in and hype you up one time. Like,
it's not just when they kill us. Okay, that's all I'm gonna say for today, y'all, because I'm all up Church is in my last name, but I'm gonna just go on and stop.
Hey, yo, Tabernacle.
Well, see y'all later. We're gonna sign off. Much love to everybody.